Thank you. Thank you. That was beautiful, Rob and Myrna. Good evening and welcome everyone to Unity's Christmas Eve service on Zoom. And before we begin, I'd like to thank everyone who made this worship happen this Christmas Eve. Suzanne, Unity's tech person, who has been incredible. And Myrna, our organist, who has worked magic with the music tonight, and all the participants, especially the children, and everyone who has joined us on Zoom. Blessings to you and your family on this holiest of nights. And tonight we celebrate the birth of the Messiah. Tonight is a night of feeling joy. A night the angels filled the sky and sang, "Glory to the newborn King." This holy night in the little town of Bethlehem over 2,000 years ago, we received the greatest gift of all.
Please join me in the call to worship. Draw near, dear friends and neighbors. Join us in this holy place, where we will hear again, in a new way, the ancient story. We long to be here at this holy time, where we sing again the songs that have woven their magic into our hearts, where we pray for one another and our beautiful yet aching world. As we gather on this dark December night, we realize that Christmas Day has already dawned and the celebrations have already begun in parts of our world. Yet we take our place and join in the global procession of welcoming once again the Christ child, praying that this Prince of Peace may enter into our warring world and into our lives. Our gathering here tonight, the longest night, is a brilliant defiance of all that would break our spirits and our hearts. Tonight, we acknowledge that God is with us wherever we are, in sorrow and in joy, and fills us with the irrepressible Holy Spirit. Let us be open to the mystery of God's love. Let us pray. Mysterious and loving God, Great Spirit, present in this very moment and place, we have come to make room for you in our hearts this night. Into this world of chaos and census, of war and occupation, of poverty and injustice, we remember that you came long ago to bring new life. We celebrate that you came in the vulnerability of a child, born among us long ago in a stable in Bethlehem. Be reborn in us even now, we pray. May your spirit dwell in us that we might give birth to your promise of peace and new life in our world. In Jesus' name, amen.
And we hold him for the King of Ages. Hi. So over the 4 weeks of Advent, we have lit an Advent candle recalling our 4 week journey of reflection on the themes of peace, hope, joy, and love in the world and in our lives. It is a time of renewal of our faith. And it has been every year since we began to celebrate the birth of the Christ child. We know that God is with us for long ago, over 2,000 years ago. On this holy night, an angel of the Lord sang to the lowly shepherds, "Do not be afraid, for I bring you good news of great joy for the people. To you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord." What gifts does Jesus bring to our broken world? Jesus brings hope for the future, peace like a river, joy everlasting, and love for all. Hope for the healing of creation and a world where everyone works together for the common good of all. Christmas is the beginning of a new world, a better world that we are boldly invited to create together as followers of the Christ child. Peace, where diversity is celebrated and every family is welcomed, regardless of culture, gender, color, or skill set. Joy, where everyone feels valued and loved. And love, where everyone knows that they are cherished as a sacred creation of God. Tonight, we light the Christ candle in celebration of the coming of the light of God to the world in human form, whom we know as Jesus Christ, the light of the world. May the light of Christ shine brightly in all of our hearts tonight and every day of 2023. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from the prophet Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people cheer when dividing plunder, for the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders. The rod of their oppressors you have broken, for a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. May it be so.
Did you know that your baby boy Responsive reading, Psalm 96. Sing to God a new song. Sing your praise to all the earth. Sing and bless God's holy name. Tell the glad news of salvation from day to day. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but you, O God, made the heavens. Worship God in the beauty of holiness, and let the whole earth stand in awe. Say among the nations, it is God who reigns. God judges the people with equity. Let the heavens rejoice and the earth be glad. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the fields exult and all that is in them. Then let all the trees of the forest sing for joy, for you come, O God, to judge the earth and its peoples in righteousness.
I'm so delighted to bring our final Christmas story to you today. It's a little bit noisy here because I'm reading it from the manger out by the street, and we'll see how that goes. But today's story for Christmas Eve is Pippin the Christmas Pig. It's written by Jean Little and illustrated by Warner Zimmerman. Pippin stared up at Naughty, the grumpy old donkey. "Naughty, you look all excited," she said. "Of course I'm excited," said Naughty. "It's Christmas." "What's Christmas?" Pippin asked. "What's Christmas?" Naughty repeated. "Don't be pig ignorant, Pippin. Everybody knows about Christmas." The tips of Pippin's ears went very, very pink. "I hope you remember that my family gave the very first gift," Naughty went on. "The baby's mother rode on a donkey all the way to Bethlehem. Christmas couldn't even begin until she got there." The curl went out of Pippin's tail. "Nobody told me a thing about Christmas," she said. "My mother said they were almost late because of that slowpoke donkey," Bess said with a gentle moo. "My great-great-great-grandmother gave her manger for the baby's bed. Without her, they would have had to put the baby to sleep on the floor. The best present was that manger." "What baby? What manger?" Pippin begged. Nobody noticed her. "And I still don't know what Christmas is," she said. "The hay in that manger was full of prickles," muttered Curly. "They would have scratched the child's face. One of my family had to give the mother a lamb's fleece to cushion the rough bed. The soft wool was a welcome gift, I can tell you." Pippin's ears were now bright pink. "But where were the pigs?" she demanded in her biggest voice. "Don't fret, Pippin," Bess said. "Christmas has nothing to do with pigs. What present could a pig possibly give a baby anyway? Especially a baby as special as this one. If there were donkeys and cows and sheep, there must have been pigs," Pippin stated. Once again, nobody was listening to her. "My very great grandparents sang him to sleep," said Cuckoo, Cooloo the pigeon. "The crowds of angels and shepherds kept him awake until my family crooned a lullaby. That song was the first importance that night." Pippin stamped her tiny hoof. "But what did the pigs do?" she said. "There must have been there, and they must have done something." "No pigs were there," the other scoffed. "The very idea. The child was a king. That holy stable was no place for pigs." Then Bess spoke up. "Pippin, face it. What could pigs have given a holy child? Pigs have nothing worthy. Pippin hung her head. The barn door stood open a crack, and slowly she went toward it. Then she pushed it farther open with her snout. She had to get away. Once outside, she waited. They might call her back. Nobody called. They had not even noticed her leaving. I'm going where pigs matter, but Christmas doesn't, Pippin announced in a shaking voice. And I won't come back. Never, ever. As she set out, a gust of wind struck her full in the face. Snowflakes stung her eyes and frosted the tips of her ears. She almost fled right back inside, but she forced herself to go forward. The cold was bitter. Soon, Pippin could no longer see the barn through the swirling snow. She passed a tattered scarecrow who leered and waved one ragged arm at her. Farther on, she saw a blue jay with its feathers all blown backward. The hunched bird was too miserable to warn the world of the little pig's passing. Pippin's feet hurt and her tail stiffened into a curly icicle. I will die out here, she whimpered, stumbling on. If I don't turn back, I will perish. But she had sworn never to go back. They didn't want her. They said that pigs were no good. At long last, Pippin reached the main road and she peered up at the mailbox and wished she could climb inside, but she passed it and kept going. Down the road, she stopped to catch her breath, and through the snow, she glimpsed a woman coming toward her carrying a baby in her arms. Pippin moved closer for a better look. The woman staggered. She had no gloves or hat, and her jacket was thin. And the little girl, so sound asleep that her head mid-nodded on her mother's shoulder, looked too heavy for her to carry much further. Poor things, Pippin murmured, forgetting about her own troubles for a moment. Shh, the woman crooned to her baby. We have so far to go, but maybe we can find a nice warm barn to rest in. And she shivered. Pippin knew where to find a warm barn. She had sworn never to return there, but this was an emergency. Follow me, she grunted, and nudged the woman along the road until they came to the long farm lane. Maybe the wind had dropped, for Pippin felt a little warmer, and even the scarecrow's smile looked friendlier. At the barn door, the little pig pushed ahead. Listen to me, she called to the animals. Don't interrupt, Pippin, said Naughty. We're making Christmas plans. I don't care, Pippin yelled. Whatever Christmas was, it was long ago. I have a baby right here who needs a place to sleep right now. Bess's jaw dropped as she saw the woman clutching the baby. It's Christmas all over again, the woman whispered as she entered the barn. Gently, she laid her baby down in the manger's sweet hay. The baby curled up and started sucking her thumb. Bless you, little pig. It is warm here, the woman murmured, settling onto a nearby heap of hay. Warm and safe. My word, they're both asleep already, Kuru whispered a moment later. Then all the animals stared at Pippin. Who is this woman? Curly snapped. Pippin. We can't take in some homeless nobody, Naughty added. My very great, Bess began. We'll need milk, Pippin said. We'll need some warm, soft wool. We'll need your old blanket, Naughty. We'll need lots of lullabies. Your very great grandparents aren't here. You must help this baby yourselves. But that's not a special baby, Naughty protested. Of course she is, said Pippin. All babies are special. Naughty gazed into the small, sleeping face. You're right, he said. I'd forgotten. When the farmer and his wife came out to feed their animals, they saw the young woman covered with Noddy's old blanket asleep in the hay. Then they caught sight of the baby girl lying in the manger. "It's Christmas," the man said softly, "right here in our barn. It's a miracle." "Hush," his wife whispered. "Let them sleep. We'll watch and see if they need our help later on." When the couple left, Pippin looked around and saw what they had seen. Noddy's warm blanket, Curly's soft wool, Bess's manger and milk. "You were right," she said. Her tail drooped. "None of these gifts is from me. Pigs really do not have anything to give. Thank you all for being so kind to them." The other animals looked down at the little piglet. "Oh, Pippin, what a silly you are," Bess said softly. "You gave us our very own Christmas. You gave us a chance to give ourselves instead of boasting about our grandparents. Don't you see? That was the best gift of all." "It took a runty pig," laughed Noddy, "to teach us what Christmas is." Merry Christmas, everyone. May God bless you and keep you this Christmas Eve and awaken you to wonder and magic that Christmas brings. Talk to you soon.
In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. That was the first registration, and it was taken while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph had to go from the town of Nazareth to Galilee, to Judah, to the city of David called Bethlehem. Because he was descended from the house and family of David, he went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who he was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver the child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there's no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. There an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone above them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth. Peace among those whom he favors." Herein is God's word.
Music is powerful. It is the language of joy, of hope, love, and victory. An old Jewish legend states that after God had created the world, he called the angels together and asked them what they thought of it. One angel said, "The only thing lacking is the sound of praise to the Creator." So God created music from the sounds of the wind and the rain and the waves and the birds, and put songs of praise into the grateful hearts and minds of God's people. That's why the Christmas Eve service is filled with beautiful music. It is the sound of praise to the Maker. The first Christmas song ever written, except for Mary's song, the Magnificat, where Mary sings that her spirit magnifies God, her Savior, is the heavenly host of angels singing Jesus' theme song, created especially for him as he is about to enter the world. Can you imagine a heavenly host of angels filling the sky? Well, picture a heavenly army of angels filling the sky that first Christmas Eve, announcing that God reigns, meaning that cosmic rule has come in the person of Jesus the Christ. It means peace, and the earliest Christians sang and praised God with joy ever since the year AD 375, which is over 1600 years ago. And our world continues to need to sing anew the songs of old that tell of good news and hope for all creation. And there's something special about singing in the darkness. Wars have even stopped on Christmas Eve, and the soldiers have stood up to sing Silent Night under the open sky. Many people tonight are experiencing despair and hopelessness as they were thousands of years ago. And each one of us here tonight has been touched by darkness at some point or another in our lives, when we too experienced fear and loneliness. But praise God, the light shone and overcame the darkness, if even for a short time. The good news of the Christmas story is that whatever happens, the light of love incarnate, whom we know as Jesus, will always shine and show us the way. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Joy.
That was beautiful, Karina. The scripture reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 15 to 20. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told. Herein is wisdom. What happened to Mary that first Christmas night is a mystery that defies believing. But we know that God was at work in Mary's life. We can't even imagine what Mary, a teenager, must have felt. She at first was greatly troubled when the angel spoke to her, saying, "Hail, O favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you amongst women." And before Mary could be overcome with fear, God spoke to her and said, "Do not be afraid." She pondered in her heart what she was told by the angel. She thought deeply about what she heard and at first told no one. She didn't run to her mother or even to Joseph, as she was overcome and knew this was an awesome event. How could she ever get anyone to believe her? She couldn't. There's mystery here, great mystery. The mystery of God doing the unexpected. But more than that, the mystery of the virgin birth, the mystery of the incarnation, God coming to earth in human flesh as a baby. many of us still cannot believe in divine intervention. But the response is, nothing is impossible with God. You're still alive. Or you met the right partner for life. Or your surgery was a success. It has been said that if nothing miraculous occurred at the event of Jesus' conception, then it had to mean that Jesus had a natural father, either Joseph or someone else. The New Testament writers knew there was something divine about Jesus. The miracle of Mary's pregnancy is not the only miracle recorded in the Bible. Mary's cousin Elizabeth was beyond the usual age of getting pregnant, and she gave birth to John the Baptist when she was 88 years old. And as time went on, we may realize that these could be myths written to convey religious truths about God as mystery. Does it really matter? But no one will deny that there is a wonderful mystery at the heart of all creation, that all life is sacred and a gift. Accepting divine intervention at work in our lives to Christians is the basis of our faith in answered prayer. Jesus' birth was heralded as a continuation of God's kingdom through the lineage of King David. But many Christians are more comfortable with calling God's reign kingdom, which expands our understanding of freedoms, human rights, acceptance, and justice for all, including those of humble heritage. May it be so. Amen. Pray. Creator, holy parent of us all, you are our Alpha and Omega, our beginning and our end, and everything in between. Even when we distance ourselves from you, you never abandon us and never will. You sent us Jesus as a child to show us the way to live, and you sent your Holy Spirit to awaken us and to empower us. Claimed as your beloved child, we sing our praises and proclaim our gratitude and love for you. We bring to you our sorrow for what is going on in the world and pray that you will bring an end to the war against Ukraine, an end to human trafficking, an end to human rights abuses in Palestine and many other countries. Show us how to be good disciples of Christ and help bring justice, hope, and healing where there is none. Forgive us for our failure to do our part to help those less fortunate. May the love of the Christ child be born and reborn in our hearts, bringing new hope and forgiveness into our hearts. And in the silent moments that follow, we lift our prayers to you either out loud or in silence. Compassionate God, hear these our prayers, and in your love answer as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We have heard the good news of the Christmas story once again. And so let us leave this holy place in our homes, feeling the awe of God's presence. Let us take the light of God's love with us into our homes, our places of work, our community, and beyond. And may the blessing of the triune God, creator of all, the baby born in a stable named Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit be our courage and strength to help make a difference in the world. Amen.